stood in awe of nobody. In his own world, and he knew no other, he was sure that he was the greatest man who'd ever been or ever could.
The newspapers of the 1880s dubbed him the Boston Strong Boy and his fistic holiness. But admirers didn't use those tags. Just saying John L. was enough. Boxing writer and historian, Bert Sugar.
Maybe after George Washington, he was our first icon. He was the biggest thing we had between the Civil War and the Spanish-American War. In any field, he was a hero.
Born 1858 in Boston, he would be boxing's last bare-knuckle champion and the first heavyweight champion under the new Marquis of Queensberry rules, requiring the use of gloves. Sullivan's popularity was aided by his feud with Richard Kyle Fox, a New York newspaper publisher who was then boxing's most powerful figure. In 1881, Fox sought to dethrone Sullivan with chosen challenger Paddy Ryan. But Ryan lasted barely 3 minutes against the champion. America adored this ring wonder, Bert Sugar.
There was even the great saying back in the 1890s, shake the hand of the hand that shook the hand of John L. Sullivan.
All right, and that's a little bit from an ESPN thing called In This Corner, John L. Sullivan. You can find that on our website, ringsideboxingshow.com, in the Box Docs Theater area, which has a whole bunch of cool documentaries, doesn't it, Joe?
Yeah, really. I'm there almost every day myself.
Today's featured guest is the official boxing historian of the Ringside Boxing Show, and he's a columnist at ringsideboxingshow.com. He's from Phoenix, Arizona, where I haven't checked the temperature today, but it's probably hot enough to light your nose hairs on fire, as usual. And he joins us today to tell the story of the last major bare-knuckled boxing match in recorded history between John L. Sullivan and a fellow by the name of Jake Kilrain. Christopher James Shelton's with us right now. Christopher, how are you, man?
Good, doing great. Thanks.
Good deal. How hot is it?
Today it's pretty hot. I'm not actually outside, but the last couple of days it's been around 110 in that area. Wow. Not as quite a hot a summer as some Phoenix summers, but it's pretty hot.
Well, you got air conditioning this year, too.
I can't believe it. A new landlord, a doctor from California, and I have air conditioning.
Wow. All right. Hey, Chris, this is the first thing people probably should understand about this fight that occurred in July of 1889 at a time when John L. Sullivan was already a gloved boxer. Bare-knuckle boxing was illegal, and Sullivan really didn't want to do it anymore, and he actually created glove boxing in this country, at least. Why did he agree to this fight?
Just money. Money was the only reason. In fact, it is sort of unusual that he's viewed in many ways as a bare-knuckle fighter because of this Kilrain fight, but he was the one that introduced gloves to American boxing, insisted that all his bouts would be by gloves. Some people think that Corbett and Sullivan was the first glove championship fight. It's like, no, every Sullivan fight when he was champion was a gloved fight except for two. He introduced probably the most famous aspect of boxing. It's probably the knockout. The knockout came because of glove fighting in John L. Sullivan.
And Christopher, Sullivan was said to be the biggest sports superstar in the country or even the world by then. Is that accurate?
It was without a question the most famous sports celebrity. The only question is, was he the most famous celebrity, period? And I believe he was. I believe when General Grant, President Grant, died, that John L. Sullivan was probably the most recognized American.
Hey, Chris, what do you know about this guy, Richard Kyle Fox, who was a newspaper publisher in New York? What role did he play in Sullivan's rise to fame?
Well, he you know, ran an influential newspaper that, you know, covered boxing, covered a lot of, you know, it was kind of a lurid newspaper. They had, talked stories about prostitutes and boxing and mixed them together, figuring, hey, that's what guys like. But he was important because he represented an American angle to that John L. Sullivan was not the champion in 1889. His paper came out and said that Jake Kilrain was the legitimate champion. Europe had come out and said Jake Kilrain was the legitimate champion. So this sort of forced Sullivan to contend with somebody that was being viewed probably unfairly as an equal.
Christopher, who was Jake Kilrain, and why was this fight a big deal in boxing history?
Well, he was a Maryland fighter, and he really only, he doesn't really have the credentials you think. He fought a boxer named Jack Ashton. Jack Ashton was very popular and well-known in the 1880s, knocked him out, defeated him. Some question how well he even looked in that. And then he went to England, and he fought a series of exhibitions with Charlie Mitchell. Charlie Mitchell was a well-known pugilist who'd fought John O'Sullivan, the only person to knock John O'Sullivan down in a glove fight. And through those exhibitions, and the Europeans simply watching Jake Kilrain fight, they thought this guy looks like a fighter, that John O'Sullivan had a reputation for not really being a smart boxer and being out of shape. So it started, you know, dawning on people, especially with Charlie Mitchell as his trainer, hey, this guy could not only legitimately give Sullivan fits, but could probably beat him, maybe even easily.
Hmm. And why did they want to make this a bare knuckle event rather than fighting with gloves?
Because nobody thought John O'Sullivan could be defeated by gloves. In fact, the irony is this was meant to make the fight less violent. It was all the brainchild of Charlie Mitchell. And Charlie Mitchell had, again, he'd fought John O'Sullivan, lots of exhibitions beyond fighting him officially for the championship. And Charlie Mitchell had devised a strategy using boxing bare-knuckle rules that allowed you to avoid the other person. And he felt that basically by sort of running away from Sullivan and exhausting him, that was the way to beat him.
Now, Sullivan and Kilrain fought 75 rounds in 75 minutes. The final 10 rounds of the Sullivan-Charlie Mitchell fight took 2 hours. What was it about bare-knuckle boxing? What constituted a round in those days? It wasn't a three-minute round back then, I assume.
No, absolutely. And that was one of the things that confused Americans about this fight. They were used to gloved fights. So they were used to rounds being 3 minutes. Sometimes gloved rounds were 2 minutes. Most of them were 3 minutes, like we're familiar with today. A bare-knuckle round could last, you know, unlimited until a hand, an elbow, a knee touched the ground. The round did not conclude. So that's why Charlie Mitchell had devised the fight before against Sullivan. He managed to get a draw to Sullivan by, egging it into a bare-knuckle fight. And all he did was, for the final 8 rounds that covered over 2 hours, in the pouring rain, he simply stayed away from John O'Sullivan, called him names, and at a certain point, John O'Sullivan was so exhausted, he just stood in one place for over 2 hours until he agreed to a draw. And that draw, for Charlie Mitchell, it was really great for him and something he could brag about and use to make money in Europe while Americans viewed him as a coward for not fighting him. But it was a way to avoid fighting John O'Sullivan.
And we all know how surly French people can be. That fight was in France in front of a bunch of rich Frenchmen who were standing in the pouring rain. They weren't very happy, were they?
No, I don't suppose they were, and I know the reporters weren't. They were wealthy. It was held in France. It was wealthy patrons, and they're only listed to be about 20, 25 people at the fight.
Krista, who was Charles Rich, and what role did he play in facilitating this fight?
Charles Rich was a wealthy landowner in Mississippi. He had a lot of influence, corrupt, influence over the legislature, law enforcement, and he was going to offer the private land for this fight to take place.
Now, what about John Fitzpatrick? Tell us his story and how he fits into this one.
John Fitzpatrick was the referee of both championship fights, bare-knuckle championship fights in Mississippi between Patty Ryan and Sullivan and between Kilrain and Sullivan. And he was a New Orleans sort of a law enforcement official. He'd been a sheriff, state legislator. He eventually became the mayor. But he was the person that was friends with Charles Rich, and they are the ones that were going to sort of pretend it was going to happen in New Orleans, but they knew it was going to happen in Mississippi, and they knew where, but they were trying to keep it as a hidden from the governor.
Oh, now, the governor of Mississippi at the time was a guy named Robert Haynes Lowry. Now, this guy wasn't exactly a bare-knuckle boxing advocate. Can you tell us a little bit about him?
Yeah, he's a really interesting man because in some ways he came across as a villain, and yet he was really an upholder of following the laws. He had become governor in 1881, and he'd become informed that John O'Sullivan was going to fight this illegal fight in his territory. And so he helped the state legislature enact basically a John O'Sullivan law to keep him from doing that. And Sullivan did it anyway, and they managed to sneak in, fight in Mississippi, and go. So when this fight came around in 1889, it was pretty open that they were going to do it in Mississippi and violate the law. And this guy was very determined. He was an ex-brigadier general with the Confederacy. He respected, his state. And I don't know if he hated bare-knuckle fighting, but he said, you're not going to come from the East, especially these former Union people. You are not going to come into my territory and break the law.
Sullivan Kilrain was one of the first American sports events to receive national media coverage. Is that right?
I'm not sure about that. I think I would probably say that Kilrain was probably one of the only people that was linked as an opponent. Sometimes you need a rivalry. You need two people for a rivalry. I would say that probably Yankee Sullivan and Tom Heyer received a lot of attention in 1849. And then John L. Sullivan fights received quite a bit of attention, but they were mostly just John L. Sullivan fights versus whoever, and John L. Sullivan would win by knockout. This is the first one that had a challenger attached to it, and the fact that it was bare knuckle, and that people were astounded by the amount of rounds a bare knuckle fight could have and were confused by that, made it definitely the most famous fight of his career.
Now, was this fight supposed to take place in New Orleans?
No, it was never supposed to take place in New Orleans, but New Orleans with Fitzpatrick, that was his base. They were using that as the final stepping stone of sneaking into Mississippi. But they lied and said it was going to be held there. They lied and said it happened in 1882 when Ryan fought Sullivan. In fact, when you asked John Sullivan, where did you fight these fights? He says, I don't know where I was. I think I was in Louisiana, but he knew he was in Mississippi. And New Orleans, again, was an instigator of breaking the law in Mississippi.
But was Sullivan a guy who could walk down the street in just about any city and be recognized at that point?
Yeah, he really was. John L. Sullivan, I don't think he tried for anonymity. John L. Sullivan was John L. Sullivan, and he advertised that he was John L. Sullivan, and people recognized him, yelled he was, you know, the champion. He was just a very famous person, and he didn't try to hide in any sort of anonymity. He liked his fame. He didn't like boxing at a certain point, but he always liked his fame.
And he was a guy who was famous for walking into bars. He originated the phrase, I can lick any man in the joint, didn't he?
You know, he probably did, absolutely, because one thing, he didn't have to be in a bar. He took his alcohol kind of wherever he was, and there's just numerous instances of Sullivan being abusive, whether at baseball games or at any sort of events, where he would threaten people and then, you know, threaten to knock them out. And, you know, he was bigger than life as a celebrity, and he used that, especially with alcohol, to be, you know, I don't a-hole, to be a not-so-great person sometimes.
We're talking to Christopher James Shelton, who is the official boxing historian of the Ringside Boxing Show, making how many times have you been on with us? Half dozen now?
Yeah, I've been on around about 10 times.
Yeah, you might be the, except for Garcia Boxing, you're probably our leader here.
Right on.
Sullivan trained for this fight in Belfast, New York. I guess that's upstate, isn't it? Do you know?
Yeah, I don't know.
We stumped Chris Shelton. I'll be darned. Wow. Okay. His trainer was a guy named William Muldoon, whose biggest challenge was keeping Sullivan sober. A writer from New York, a guy named Arch Merrill, wrote that a common cry in the village up there was that John L. is loose again, send for Muldoon. What can you tell us about this Muldoon guy and his relationship with Sullivan?
Well, Muldoon was his friend, his best friend, was his trainer, and he did have to really, he was a big guy, he was a professional wrestler, he was bigger than Sullivan, and he really had to more, in a way what that person said was untrue, but it's also true that Muldoon was his babysitter, and that he was the one who had to push Sullivan, that you've got to run, you've got to, you know, watch what you're eating, you do got to watch what you're drinking while you're in training, and Sullivan would growl every step of the way, so Muldoon really had to keep him disciplined, because John L. Sullivan could not self-discipline.
How illegal was boxing, bare-knuckle boxing at that time? Wikipedia can be a pretty dodgy source for facts, so check me on this. But what I read on Wikipedia this morning was on July 8, 1889, the morning of the fight, about 3,000 spectators boarded special trains in Mississippi, and that took them to that secret location where the fight was going to be held, a little town called Richburg, which apparently is just south of Hattiesburg, or was. And so it sounds like most of the enforcers were looking the other way. They're kind of winking at this fight and allowing it to happen. Is that kind of the way it was?
Well, I think Wikipedia, you know, you get what you deserve. You know, exactly the Oxford Dictionary. Or definitions. No, it was held in Marion County, and the town that had jurisdiction was Purvis, Mississippi. And we know this because of the arrests. So we know the jurisdiction of where they fought. As far as 3,000 people, You know, you'd have to sort of guess at it, and I would cut that number down to almost something like 1,000. It was very common for John L. Sullivan to have fights where 10,000, even in San Francisco, 15,000 people showed up. But the problem with the bare knuckle is you have to find a location. A, it has to be flat land for 24 feet for the ring, and then you have to have a rising slope to put these people. And because there's a couple photographs, we can see there was a rising slope, and there were benches, but there had to be people in these bare knuckle things, you know, standing on rocks and standing in trees to see, because if they can't and you go all the way out there and you can't see, you start pushing and shoving to see, and there wasn't anything like that. So there were a lot of people. For 1,000 people for a bare knuckle fight that's illegal is a lot of people.
Now, Sullivan was a guy who probably didn't mind going to the bar the night before the fight and getting all corned up. I saw a report that said that the first half of this fight didn't go all that well for Sullivan, and he actually ended up vomiting in about the 44th round. But then he got a second wind after that, and Kilrain's manager threw in the towel after round 75. Is that the way you understand it happened?
Well, no, I wouldn't say it exactly happened that way. I would say that for the first 4-plus rounds, Jake Kilrain would have appeared to be doing very well against John L. Sullivan. And the first four rounds constituted over 20% of the fight as far as length. The fourth round was over 15 minutes all by itself. And Sullivan, Kilrain had inflicted some damage on Sullivan. He had injured his eye, and he intentionally spiked him with his foot. Remember, because they're on the ground, they wore spiked shoes. He spiked Sullivan on the foot. So Sullivan had this foot injury, and then he had this eye that was swelling. But also, so what Kilrain had done is he completely worn himself out. He had completely misjudged the Mississippi humidity, and one of the things underestimated in boxing then and now are body blows. And Sullivan was mostly pounding it at Kilrain's heart. So he's probably inflicting damage that wasn't obvious in a physical way. Almost any time after the 15th round, Sullivan began dominating, but he was angry that the fight hadn't been stopped. And yes, his poor conditioning got the best of him, and he did start vomiting in the 44th round. And that led to Sullivan not only being enraged and sick, and it's possible that he could have been even disqualified, not for vomiting, but he wasn't ready on the 30 seconds time like you're supposed to be. And at that point, for the next two or three rounds, Sullivan began openly cheating. And one of the things he did is when they both wrestled and fell to the ground, it was only like a 15-second round. As Sullivan was getting up and Kilrain was on the ground, Sullivan intentionally kneed him right to the face. And that could have been the disqualification. And in fact, he was charged with a crime for that. And the people that reported that they saw it were Mississippi law enforcement officials, the cops. So obviously the cops aren't supposed to be there if it's illegal. They're supposed to stop it. And instead they're watching and encouraging it.
Was wrestling real common in bare knuckle fights? Did they get on the ground and actually wrestle for a while sometimes?
It absolutely probably depended on wrestling was a part of bare knuckle, and it absolutely depended on certain pugilists used it more, certain pugilists used it less. Sullivan really just wanted to punch out. Kilrain, because of Charlie Mitchell, thought initially they would try to wrestle with Sullivan, but by the fifth round, Kilrain didn't have the physical strength to throw Sullivan anymore.
How much did Sullivan and Kilrain earn for the fight?
Well, we know that it was approximately $22,000 was held because John Fitzpatrick, the referee, was caught by law enforcement trying to sneak from Mississippi to New Orleans, back to New Orleans, and it wasn't for this fight. It was afterwards he snuck in. It was half-clothed when they brought him into Judge Terrell, and Judge Terrell at that point said this is a $22,000 fight. So he put on the record $22,000. What did they earn? They earned nothing. Jake Kilrain lost, and the New York Times said all he received was a beating. In fact, they asked the Mississippi to be merciful to Kilrain. But Sullivan, they wanted to throw the book at him, and Sullivan basically lost all the money that he could have earned through legal fees.
Both guys actually...
Lawyers made the money, and the gamblers made the money.
Just like today.
Just like today. There you go.
Both of these guys actually became hunted fugitives afterward, but the law caught up with Sullivan on a train in Nashville. Now, did he go peacefully?
He went about as unpeacefully as someone could go. it is really interesting that, in fact, Judge Lauer, the governor of Mississippi, put out an arrest warrant for Sullivan breaking the law, and the Tennessee State Police received the warrant and decided to arrest him while he was on a Nashville train. Sullivan would not go voluntarily, which really shocked the chief of police. He thought this was going to be a peaceful thing. He was with four other officers, and there are other officers outside. And Sullivan said he wasn't going to talk to him. One of Sullivan's men said, "No, Sullivan's asleep." And they said, "Hey, wake him up." And then Sullivan tried to pretend he was still asleep, and so the chief of police shook shook him, and Sullivan said, "Get the hell away from me. I'm trying to sleep." He's talking that way to the chief of police. So then the chief of police told the four officers to draw guns and to shoot Sullivan if Sullivan, you know, decided to physically brawl. Well, Sullivan didn't care, and he refused to go. So the chief of police said, "You know, that's it. You know, this is turning into a nightmare. The railroad was going to go," and then they ordered the railroad not to go. And the railroad said, "Well, we're run by federal law, not the law of Tennessee." And they said, "Well, no, you're in Tennessee. You're going to follow Tennessee law." So they said, "No, we're not. We're going." And so they said, "Well, we're going to cut off the Sullivan cart." And so the rest of the railroad train can go, but not Sullivan. So they stayed in place. And so then finally, tired of this, the chief of police finally grabbed Sullivan and said, "You know, you're under arrest and you're going with us." And Sullivan shoved him. And then all four officers and the chief of police wrestled and fought with Sullivan in a brawl, 5-on-1, just like you think would be made up, but it actually happened. And finally, they put restraints on one Sullivan hand, restraints on another Sullivan hand, and he was held in custody and, of course, unfortunately, released.
How has this story not become a Hollywood movie? They haven't made a movie about this, have they?
Oh, I can't believe it, especially if you get around to Judge Terrell in his courtroom. Yeah, that should definitely be a movie in itself.
We'll come to that in a minute, yeah. Okay, so the Tennessee judge decided not to prosecute him for some reason, but the governor in New York honored the arrest warrant and convinced Sullivan somehow to return to Mississippi to stand trial. So, okay, tell us about the presiding judge in Mississippi and the courtroom where Sullivan stood trial.
Absolutely. Just one more thing, because you mentioned, was there 3,000 spectators? One thing we do know, there were 5,000 spectators as Sullivan gave in to Governor Hill in New York, waiting to see would Sullivan surrender. 5,000 people just to get news on this. Sullivan was told, you know what, this is not going to be a big deal. You're better off to go back there. He did agree. He had no idea in his courtroom, which was just a barber shop and a courtroom simultaneous. It only had one chair to sit in. It was a barber chair. And that was for the district attorney. And Judge Terrell presided behind a counter where they make the sales and the barber stuff. And Sullivan had no idea what was waiting for him, because Judge Terrell, he was the Judge Judy of his time. He was mean.
So Sullivan was expecting a light sentence, right? Like 3 to 10 days in jail.
Absolutely. He was told he probably would get a suspended sentence with a fine, but he was told possibly 3 days, at worst 10 days. And so it says on D-Nice, you know, in front of the judge, and that kind of thing. And the jurors convicted him, thinking also, and they even put in a recommendation that no jail time be allowed. And Judge Terrell, the first words out of his mouth were, "Stand up, Sullivan." And Sullivan was shocked, and everybody was shocked, because nobody talked to John L. Sullivan that way. And then he put a dressing down on Sullivan that, because of you, you not only broke the law, but you encouraged thousands of people to break the law, from the railroads to the states of New York, Maryland, Louisiana. All of this is because of you. You're the number one reason this happened. Even the New York Times has sort of pulled away and said, you know what? Kilrain and Sullivan were dupes. There were these other people making money, these other people that encouraged it, and they're not going to get in trouble. But Terrell said, nope, you're the number one ringleader. Threw the book at him. He was convicted of a misdemeanor of participating in a prize fight. Judge Terrell gave him a year in jail.
At hard labor.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, this Sullivan was shocked beyond shocked. So the first thing he did was post bond and bail Mississippi. And, man, he said, I ain't going back. This is too brutal. But Jake Kilrain had not been sent to Mississippi, and he knew that Sullivan had this 1 year in sentence posed on him. And while he knew he was viewed as the number two reason that this occurred, John Fitzpatrick was sentenced after Sullivan. I think that was very intentional. I think Terrell wanted Fitzpatrick to see what happened to Sullivan and let him shake in his boots a little bit. But he only fined him $200 and said that, you know, basically you were the third person responsible for this happening.
Chris, when they talk about hard labor back then, do you have any idea what that meant?
No, I hate to think of it. I've seen The Longest Yard a few times with Burt Reynolds. I hate to think you're digging mud, you know, digging ditches and stuff. But I know that one thing, that there would have been a real attempt to influence people, and probably because we know what happened to Jake Kilrain. Jake Kilrain basically gave himself up. He admitted that he said, I'm not the number two person. I'm number one along with John L. Sullivan. If he's, you know, in trouble, I'm in trouble. And he was expecting 6 months, and Judge Terrell was somewhat merciful and gave him only 2 months. But then we know that Charles Rich had some kind of loophole in the Mississippi law that allowed you to purchase prisoners so that you could be their jailer. So he probably would have done this to John L. Sullivan, too. He purchased Jake Kilrain for $1,000 and then basically let Jake Kilrain hang out, eat food, and do whatever he wanted. So there wasn't any punishment at all. And probably Sullivan would not have. But Sullivan, you know, had been spooked by this Governor Lowry and spooked by Judge Terrell that, hey, these guys are freaks about the law. And he wanted nothing to do with any of them.
So did you say he posted bond and then got the hell out?
That's exactly what he did. So then the country reacted, and the country did not react against John L. Sullivan or Jake Kilrain. Most of the country thought, hey, they didn't do anything wrong. All they did was participate in a prize fight. And what's wrong with that? So they came down especially hard on Judge Terrell, who didn't care, and Governor Lowry, who did care. And Governor Lowry and John Sullivan should have maybe taken this deal. The pressure was so heavy on Governor Lowry that Governor Lowry had agreed that if John L. Sullivan simply returned and did 20 days in jail, he would commute the rest of it. John L. Sullivan wouldn't do it. And that kept this thing going until the Mississippi Supreme Court overturned the convictions. They overturned, they said, the one reason they said it was because it was on private property of Charles Rich, and they said that was legal. It was only illegal to fight in a public area. I don't know about that. And then number two, and this is interesting, they overturned the conviction on fighting a prize fight because they said that, yes, a person has to fight an opponent, and yes, John L. Sullivan fought a prize fight, but you haven't proven that he fought anyone, which is ridiculous. He didn't fight himself. So they overturned it, but they allowed the ability to prosecute again on it, and that's exactly what Governor Lowry did, and he got another grand jury to indict him for participating in a prize fight, and at that point, John L. Sullivan agreed to plead guilty, didn't go back to Mississippi, he agreed to plead guilty, a $500 fine, and it's over. So both of them have convictions on their record permanently due to this fight.
Huh. And so Sullivan, who was still undefeated, didn't defend his title for the next 4 years. How come?
He just didn't really want to fight, and he was out of shape, and he didn't want to do the conditioning. And he probably, you know, after Kilrain, he would have been wise to retire, but he didn't because his legacy got tarnished. Because at this point, they call him the colored heavyweight champion, Peter Jackson. Most people felt he was really the number one contender, even more than Jake Kilrain. And Sullivan was dodging him. And even though we think of 20 years later with Jack Johnson, how white America really rooted against Jack Johnson and stuff, a lot of white America liked Peter Jackson and felt John L. Sullivan should fight him. You know, Peter Jackson wasn't from America, he's from Australia, and he had very good manners and stuff. And John L. Sullivan, in not fighting Peter Jackson, used a lot of obscene language against black people and really tarnished his legacy in a way that he would have been maybe wiser just to retire after Kilrain.
So, okay, we're talking to Christopher James Shelton on the Ringside Boxing Show. In 1892, he fights Gentleman Jim Corbett in New Orleans, and Corbett knocked him out in the 21st round. What happened to Sullivan after that?
Well, just to really quickly say on Corbett. Corbett, for most of those rounds, he really just ran away from Sullivan. He didn't throw any punches in a lot of those rounds. But then, yes, Sullivan wore down, and Corbett knocked him out in the 21st round. Sullivan was traumatized by losing to Corbett. He hated Corbett, and Corbett sort of mocked him. So while that reign occurred, he was broke. He was an alcoholic, just a total mess. And then finally when Fitzsimmons knocked out Corbett, that was like the first lighter opening. I mean, when Sullivan lost to Corbett, there were reports that he committed suicide. And Sullivan admitted he was on suicide watch. But then it still took, after the Fitzsimmons knocking out Corbett, another 7 or 8 years when he gave up alcohol. He gave up alcohol. He met a woman. He eventually started getting his act together. He became the number one person against whiskey in America, the most famous temperance lecturer. Absolutely. And even his racial views changed when the New York Times hired him as a sports writer for the Jeffries Johnson fight, and to Sullivan's astonishment, he got along with the Johnson camp, and he got along with Johnson, Jack Johnson, and he the one racial thing he did good for America was he declared himself neutral, may the best man win, and took a lot of heat from that from certain parts of white America, but John L. Sullivan could withstand that, and then he watched the fight and was rooting for Jack Johnson, and when Jack Johnson won, Sullivan came out publicly and said the right man won.
Chris, what do you know about his Sullivan's stint as a stage actor?
Well, apparently he was a terrible stage actor, but I actually have reviews because he was the first person to have a movie that made money in Phoenix. So because of that, I got to study a little bit of his time in Arizona. And he would come out and he would do a monologue, or he would, you know, I guess it was jokes. I have no idea whether they're funny or not, because the sports writers would say very kind things and say it was very amusing. And then his partner at that time for these exhibitions would be Jake Kilrain. So they would have a little show, a sparring exhibition for three rounds. Neither one really looked like fighters at this point, but that's how they both made money. And again, one last thing to say about the bare knuckle versus why that fight's so famous was when people were used to glove fights, they were now used to fights being about 10 rounds. They were used to fights being defined by rounds. Bare knuckle wasn't defined by rounds. It was defined by length. So they were used to rounds, and six rounds, 10 rounds, and all of a sudden they see 75 rounds, not knowing bare knuckle had different rules, and it looked like they were out there fighting for 5 hours or something.
Mm-hmm. And the reason there weren't very many knockouts in bare knuckle fights is as soon as you, like you said, as soon as you, your knee or hand touched the ground, the round was over, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And also the big difference is with boxing, when we think of a knockout, the person gets knocked down and they have 10, you count to 10, and then boom, they're out. While bare knuckle was, you know, people come out and carry you back, and you had 30 seconds. So it would end essentially by a knockout, but what they would say is you didn't rise to time. So that was mostly how they ended.
Okay, so John L. Sullivan dies. He's only 59 when he dies. $10 in his pocket. Is that right?
No, I don't think he had $10 in his pocket. He had $10 or less in his pocket while he was champion, certainly when he was post-champion. This is a guy who spent a lot of money. But he wasn't wealthy anymore, but he was still friends with, you know, Theodore Roosevelt and friends with a lot of people that had money, and he had turned his life around so that he had, you know, a somewhat respectable amount of money. He's broke a lot in his life, but not when he died.
Now, you just mentioned Teddy Roosevelt, and you were on our show a few weeks ago talking about Teddy Roosevelt, who was just a tremendous boxing fan and actually did
Absolutely.
Some boxing himself.
Absolutely.
Is there any evidence that he and John L. Sullivan ever sparred together?
No, I think, you know, there isn't. It would have been interesting to do it. I think, you know, the only reason they didn't do it, to be perfectly honest, it's kind of funny to think, but at that time, but it would have been the early, you know, 20th century, 1900, 1908, in that area, Theodore Roosevelt probably could embarrass John L. Sullivan. You wouldn't think that would be possible, but Theodore Roosevelt was in good shape, and John L. Sullivan was in miserable shape, and Theodore Roosevelt boxed all the time, and John L. Sullivan didn't box at all. So I think the president didn't want to embarrass, you know, this great man in his mind.
What's your process researching this stuff? How do you do it?
Well, I just mostly go back, like, for instance, this thing, for this fight, the easiest thing to do is just to get the papers, various papers, and just see how they're reporting the rounds and how they're reporting the fight, and see, especially when they have everything that's in agreement, it makes it easy. And then for me, I follow the human aspect, so I follow actually the whole, you know, the arrest and what happens to them and what happens involving the law and the sort of the morality play of, you know, who's doing the right thing or the wrong thing. And so it's mostly just old newspapers. I didn't use microfilm for this one. I use microfilm, but it's not easy to get microfilm from, like, the 1880s. You generally just – they have a lot of stuff online and such. But that's how I do it.
And man, using microfilm, you know, as a newspaper reporter myself, I've used that. You got to take your Dramamine in advance.
Thank you. You are so right. I'm so glad you know. It is a nightmare. It is. You go blind, and sometimes you don't find what you're looking for right away. Microfilm is a nightmare, and absolutely, you're totally right.
Yeah, it actually makes you sick to your stomach sometimes, just because just staring at that thing and moving the pages, and it's just it's hard to do. Really hard to do.
It makes you blind. It gives you headaches. It gives you a sick feeling when you can't find something, and you have to keep looking over and over through various days and stuff. You have to resist the temptation to play because there's these other fascinating new stories,
yep.
and it's just, you're right, it's miserable, but that's what you do when you want to get to the truth.
So this is not necessarily a labor of love at times for you, right?
No, it's about as much labor of love as for Sullivan fighting Kilrain.
All right, that's Christopher James Shelton on the Ringside Boxing Show. Man, you're always so damn compelling, Chris. We love having you on here.
Thank you so much.
What's your next article? Have you given any thought to it?
I have. I have been writing it for a while. I might have to write something in between Tom Heyer and Manifest Destiny about boxing from approximately, well, American history from approximately 1836 to 1864. And a lot of great Yankee Sullivan stuff, interesting stuff on Tom Heyer. But I want the America in between, the America that stole Mexico's land and the America that was reaching the end of slavery.
Awesome. Can't wait. All right. Hey, Chris, thank you very much. Christopher James Shelton on the Ringside Boxing Show. Thanks, Chris.
Thank you.